Recorded Books and One Click Digital present Nerds 5, Attack of the Bullies by Michael Buckley. Narrated by Johnny Heller.
Prologue. 38 degrees, 52 minutes north. 77 degrees, 6 minutes west. The principal of Thomas Knowlton Middle School was working at his desk when the ninjas attacked. They wore black masks and held sharp swords over their heads. One crashed through the door with a high-pitched wail, his deadly weapon slicing the air. But he was stopped in his tracks when the principal karate chopped him in the Adam's apple. Ouch! Another ninja climbed through the window, but his head was crushed when the principal slammed it shut. Oof! A third ninja dropped from an air duct in the ceiling. His nunchuck swirled in deadly arcs, wrapping around the principal's beefy forearm. But that was a mistake the ninja would forever regret, because the principal used the nunchucks to yank the ninja forward for a skull-splitting headbutt. Lights out. When it looked like the attack was over, two more ninjas popped out of the drawers of a steel file cabinet and attacked, using their fists and feet, knocking the principal backward onto his desk. They held him down and, chuckling arrogantly, removed gleaming daggers from the folds of their clothes. But the principal was trained in several martial arts and highly proficient in the monkey, snake, and crane fighting styles. Plus, he was Irish, so he knew his way around a street fight. He snatched a stapler off his desk and slammed it into one ninja's forehead and then the other's. Both men cried out in agony and stumbled backward onto the bodies of their fallen brothers. The principal stood over the pile of broken villains. Then he started to applaud. "Thanks, guys," he said.
Yeah.
The men groaned as they staggered to their feet. One of the ninjas took off his mask, revealing a chubby face and a large bald spot in the center of his curly brown hair. He didn't look like a ninja. He looked like an accountant.
"Did we at least surprise you this time?" he groused.
The principal nodded.
"Absolutely, Randy. I was completely taken off guard. I didn't see the file cabinet thing coming at all. That was a nice touch."
"He's just saying that because he doesn't want to hurt our feelings," another ninja groaned.
Underneath his mask, he had bright red hair and a face full of freckles.
"No, Barry. I really was intimidated."
Randy shook his head.
"I don't know why you want us to do this anyway. You're the boss now. Your biggest fear should be getting a paper cut or someone parking in your designated space. Why keep training?"
"You don't actually miss your old job, do you?" Barry asked.
"Miss my old job? No, that's ridiculous. Why would I miss it?"
"I have no idea," Randy said.
"It was humiliating. You're a decorated war hero, and they put you in that stupid school kitchen with a hairnet and the tater tots. What a waste. This promotion was long overdue. You deserve to be director of the National Espionage, Rescue, and Defense Society, so take it easy."
"Thanks for the pep talk, guys, but I'm fine," the principal said. "I've got to get back to work. See you next week."
"Not if we see you first," Barry said as he slunk out the window.
The others vanished through the air ducts and into the filing cabinet. In the blink of an eye, they were gone. The principal put the upended coat rack back in its place, adjusted his portrait of the President of the United States on the wall, and gathered what was left of his office supplies. He looked at the stack of paperwork on his desk and sighed. Truth was, he didn't know how to take it easy. He did miss the adventure of the field. There was nothing as satisfying as the sound of a bad guy's nose breaking beneath his fist. But what he really missed was, well, if anyone found out, he would be the laughing stock of the espionage community. He crossed the room to a small file cabinet, locked tight with 14 different deadbolts. He fished 7 of the keys out of his pockets, opened the hollow heel in his left shoe for another, found 2 in between his big toe and his second toe, and 4 more in a secret pocket at the base of his pant leg. When he had unlocked all the bolts, he opened the cabinet and pulled out his most prized possessions, a spatula, a pair of orthopedic sneakers, a hairnet, and a flowery smock. He caressed them lovingly. Why was it so hard to let go of his previous job as the school's lunch lady? Why did he miss the heat lamps, corn nuggets, and fish surprise? Suddenly the phone rang. It wasn't the phone on his desk. It was the phone. He stuffed his kitchen tools back in the cabinet and raced to his desk. Underneath his coffee mug was a glowing red button. He slammed it hard with the palm of his hand and watched as his drab, poorly decorated office went through a dramatic transformation. The yellowing walls flipped over to reveal banks of computers and electronic maps of the world. His ancient, clunky desk sank into the floor and was replaced with a blinking, beeping control panel. The grimy ceiling fan collapsed in on itself, and a large television monitor took its place. The glossy black screen blinked to life, and his boss, a tough-as-nails five-star general named Savage, appeared on it. Savage's reputation as a fearless soldier made the principal's record look downright cowardly. Rumors claimed the general once got out of a pit of quicksand just by threatening it. Now, however, Savage's massive, bullet-shaped head looked sweaty, and his tiny eyes shifted nervously.
Hello, Director. I wish I had time for a chit-chat, but we have a crisis on our hands that needs your team's attention.
What is it, sir?
We have it from good sources that the President's daughter, Tessa Lipton, is about to be kidnapped.
The principal wasn't the kind of man to gasp, but the news of such a brazen crime took his breath away.
When? How? Who?
Savage's massive head dissolved and was replaced with an image of the complete opposite. A sweet, cheerful-looking 12-year-old girl with a grin as big as the Midwestern sky. Her image morphed into a photo of an ultra-modern building.
We don't know the when or how, but we think we have a where. Sugarland Academy, a very prestigious prep school for the children of political bigwigs and power brokers. It's here in Arlington.
I know the lunch lady over there, the principal said. The security is top-notch.
Did you say you know the lunch lady there?
The general asked.
We used to trade recipes. Okay, Savage said slowly. Anyway, Sugarland is its own 12-officer police department that cooperates with Tessa's 4-man Secret Service detail.
That's a lot of eyeballs on one person, the principal said. Who would even try to kidnap her?
The image was replaced with a photo of a woman wearing a black mask with a white skull painted on it. The principal scowled.
Miss Holiday. She's calling herself Misinformation now, Savage said. We managed to get a mole inside her organization. He called it chaotic, filled with hundreds of scientists working on thousands of schemes aimed at every corner of the world. It's really breathtaking how quickly she's put this thing together.
And she's had us running ragged ever since, the principal growled. I've had to split the team to handle it all. What else is this mole saying?
Nothing, he's dead. We found his remains in the belly of a beached great white shark this morning. We've alerted the president. He and the First Lady are beside themselves with worry. If the Commander-in-Chief's own daughter can be kidnapped, what does it say about our national security?
The principal nodded.
This is not going to be easy for us, General. It will be tough to keep an eye on Tessa without her or the President knowing about it. The founders of this team were very concerned about staying out of the political maneuverings of whoever is running the country. If the politicians were to find out we had a super team at their disposal, the kids' lives would be turned upside down.
And I suggest the kids keep their powers to themselves.
No upgrades, the principal said. Good idea, sir. I'll have the kids enroll at Sugarland Academy.
I'll work with the Secret Service and the school's police, Savage said. There is one other problem, Director. Sugarland is a sophisticated school. The students are mature and cultured.
Sir?
And your kids are not, especially the hyper one.
Flinch. Don't worry, sir, the team will rise to the occasion.
And leave the crazy one at home.
The principal paused. Did the boss really think he would do something so dumb as send Heathcliff Hodges on a mission? If only there was somewhere to send him. Unfortunately, until the brains in the science department found a way to return his parents' memories of him, Heathcliff had to stay in the playground.
I don't think I have to tell you. This mission is your top priority,
Savage continued.
I know it's not easy to fill Agent Brand's shoes, but if you and the team succeed in keeping Tessa safe, no one will question your leadership.
Is someone questioning my leadership? The principal asked. But the screen had already gone black. The room's technology was quickly replaced with the drab, battered furniture of his principal's office. The principal was tempted to run to the file cabinet, snatch the spatula, and stuff it safely in the pocket of his suit jacket. It would make him feel better. But deep down, he knew Randy and Barry were right. He was the boss now. He had to put the grill in the deep fat fryer behind him.
Take me to the playground, he said out loud.
A green light flashed, and the floor beneath him opened. It was time to fight the bad guys, and he was heading toward a place where he could do just that. End transmission.
Kid, you're like bedbugs. I can't get rid of you. I've tried everything short of DDT, but you keep showing up and being annoying. First, there were those embarrassing DNA tests. Then the code-breaking quiz. Then I threw that psychological exam at you, and finally the physical challenges. Either you're passionate about being a secret agent, or you're dim in the head. My money is on you being dim. So what's left for you to prove? Nothing. You actually made it. You're a member of the National Espionage Rescue and Defense Society. Congratulations, write your code name below.
Really? You're going with that? I mean, it's not exactly intimidating. In fact, it's downright silly. Why not call yourself Fluffy Bunny or the Cabbage, huh?
My code name?
Agent Beanpole.
Shut your mouth. Beanpole is a fierce code name. And has an air of mystery about it, too.
Stop laughing. I hate you.
Let's move on. My name is Michael Buckley. I was once a member of the National Espionage Rescue and Defense Society. These days, I document their adventures and weed out the posers who want to join the team. Well, I try to weed them out. The organization was founded in the 1970s, long before you were born.
What were the 70s like?
Awesome. Everybody dressed really well, and we all had these cool haircuts.
Don't believe me?
Ask your parents to show you some pictures.
I'll wait.
See, I told you. Man, do I miss my butterfly collars. Anyway, let's get started. What you're holding in your sweaty hands is the last nerd's file. And unlike the previous four, there's no test. This case file is all about history. You're gonna get a glimpse of the greatest agents the nerds have ever seen. So read this carefully, and you might just learn something about being a spy. But I have my doubts. Level 1 access granted. Begin transmission.
Chapter 1. 54 degrees, 46 minutes north. 1 degree, 35 minutes west.
How did I get here?
Ruby Peet grumbled to herself as she climbed onto the roof of a British express train. The air was bone-rattling cold. The train was racing at nearly 140 miles an hour, and she was sure the jostling would send her flying over the side at any moment. But as they say, there isn't any use in complaining when you have a job to do, and Ruby's job was saving the world. Most people couldn't see past the fact that Ruby was in the sixth grade, only 12 years old, allergic to practically everything in the world and a social misfit. But the truth was, Pufferfish, as she was known, was actually a very good secret agent. At that moment, she was in pursuit of a scientist named Dr. Hans Julian, the world's expert on poop.
Yes, you read that correctly.
Poop.
Dr. Julian knew everything there was to know about dookie, caca, turds, racing stripes, floaters, and toilet bombs. He also knew how waste could be used for fuels, building materials, and fertilizer, plus a million other very gross things.
One could say that he was number one at number two. What he didn't know was how deep the doo-doo would be when he tried to sell some of his knowledge to a very bad person. What could a guy with a degree in dung know that would put him on the nation's most wanted list? Dr. Julian had created a super laxative that caused intensive, explosive diarrhea. One drop of that liquid in a city's water supply, and every man, woman, child, and animal would be racing to the bathroom. With everyone indisposed, any number of crimes could occur, and there would be no one to stop them. She stood, fighting the wind, and peered into the darkness. In the moonlight, she spotted Dr. Julian running away from her along the top of the train. Mustering all her courage, she darted after him. If it were up to her, she'd be calling the shots while one of her fellow agents did the legwork. Glustick could use his sticky hands and feet to never fall off the train. Braceface could snatch the doctor in a giant fist made from his orthodontic braces, and Weezer's inhalers would allow her to fly alongside the train and scoop up the bad guy in her arms. Even Flinch's sugar-fueled strength and lightning speed would easily overpower the scientist. Unfortunately, her teammates were on other missions, and Ruby was all by herself. All she had were her allergies, a collection of runny noses, swelling feet, itchy hands, rashes, hives, blisters, and weepy eyes, enhanced by the latest science. Coursing through her bloodstream were millions of nanobytes, tiny robots that made her allergic reactions so sensitive she practically had psychic powers. A puffy eye alerted her to explosives. A sudden hacking cough warned her of an assassin's presence. A swollen ankle was a clear sign that she was about to get punched in the face. Her allergies put her one step ahead of every villain, even if she would never know what peanut butter tasted like. "Dr. Julian, you don't have to do this," she cried over the howling wind. She wasn't even sure the man could hear her, but it never hurt to use reason before you started using your fists. "You can give me the vial and no one has to get hurt." Dr. Julian wheeled around, a vial of bright red liquid in his hand. "Kid, you need to leave me alone. You don't know what's going on here." "I know what you've created, and I know you plan to give it to someone who will use it to take the world hostage. I can't let you do that." Dr. Julian snarled and kept running along the top of the moving train. Ruby raced after him the best she could. At a slight bend in the track, the scientist nearly fell off. "Dr. Julian," Ruby cried. If he fell, his vial would fall. The scientist back at the playground told her that would be disastrous. The super laxative would seep into the water supply, flow into rivers and oceans, and the world would turn into one big toilet. Ruby reached the end of her car and took a wild leap, landing hard on the next car. Then she continued to run after the scientist. He had a head start, but she was faster and more agile, and soon she had cut his lead in half. "You have to stop, Dr. Julian. You know this is wrong." Julian stopped and faced her. "Kid, my work is for sale to the highest bidder. I can't stop someone from using what I create to do bad things." Ruby's hands began to swell, a clear sign that Julian was lying. There was more to the scientist's claim. A tickle in her armpit told her that Dr. Julian was being forced against his will. "Someone has threatened you," Ruby shouted. "You don't know what you're talking about," he said. "Now get lost before we both get killed." "What did they say they'd do to you?" Julian scowled. Suddenly, Ruby's eyes were swelling, which could only mean one thing. Danger. "Duck!" she shouted with no time to spare. She fell to her belly as the train plunged into a tunnel. She could feel the stone ceiling scraping against her coat, and she prayed that Dr. Julian had been able to heed her warning. When they cleared the tunnel, she got to her feet. The scientist had made it too. "Who is making you do this?" she continued. The words seemed to pain the man.
I don't know what her name is, really. She wears a mask with a skull on it."
Ruby felt the air squeeze out of her body. "Miss Holiday.
She threatened my family."
"We can protect them," Ruby said, taking a tentative step forward. "I know I look like a meddling kid who is in over her head,
but I work with some very powerful people. We can move you and your family to a place you will never find you. You can start over without fear.
Dr. Julian looked down at his vial and then back at her, clearly struggling with the decision. Ruby sympathized and wondered what she would do in the same situation. Put her trust in some kid on top of a speeding train, or risk her family's lives?
All right, kid, he said as he stretched out his arm to hand her the vial.
Ruby let out a deep breath that she hadn't realized she'd been holding.
You're doing the right thing, she said.
With her fingertips on the vial, she was suddenly overcome by a tremendous sneezing fit. The vial slipped and fell onto the top of the train. Luckily, it didn't break, but it bounced and skidded toward the far end of the car.
Hey, Pufferfish, everything okay?
A voice crackled in her head. Ruby scowled. The sneeze wasn't an allergic reaction or a touch of the flu, but what happened when a tiny communication link implanted in Ruby's nose was activated. It was supposed to keep her in close contact with her team members, but as she watched the vial disappear from view, she wished she could reach up her nostril and yank it out, especially since she knew who was on the other end. Heathcliff Hodges.
Pufferfish, can you read me?
Ruby growled.
You're not supposed to be on the comlink, Heathcliff.
I wanted to help. Have you caught Dr. Diarrhea yet? Where are you? It sounds loud.
Ruby squeezed her nose to deactivate the link and chased after the bouncing vial. It slid across the metal roof, threatening to shatter and explode at any second. She lunged face first, feeling the slick glass in her hands once more, only to lose it again when another sneeze took hold. Ruby watched the vial hop across the gap to the next car.
Hey, is everything okay? I think we got disconnected,
Heathcliff said over the link.
When you get back, we should run a diagnostic on your nostril implant.
Heathcliff, if you don't mind, I'm trying to save the world, she said,
hauling herself to her feet and disconnecting the comm link. Her eyes again on the vial, she dashed ahead, doing her best to keep her balance with the ever-changing shaking of the train. She was just about to reach down and scoop up the deadly potion again when...
Achoo!
Her right foot kicked the vial across the gap, sending it onto the next car.
You've got to be kidding me, she shouted as her fingers tingled.
She was allergic to bad timing and even more sensitive to annoying people.
I was thinking that maybe I could send a message to the conductor to stop the train. Would that help?
I've got it covered, Ruby bellowed, and this would be over if you would just leave me alone.
Oh, Heathcliff said.
She ignored the hurt in his voice. She knew he was just trying to help, but she didn't have time for him. She squeezed her nose again to shut him out and leaped across the gap. Unfortunately, this landing was not as lucky as the previous ones. Her feet touched down on a patch of black ice that sent her slipping and tumbling over the side of the car. She survived only by snatching a metal railing on the roof with one hand and grabbing the vial out of the air with the other. Strong gusts sent her crashing into the side of the train as she struggled to pull herself back up with one arm. She imagined the bewildered passengers gaping at her through the windows and hoped they would be smart enough to look away before she fell, which was exactly what was going to happen. She just didn't have the upper body strength to hold on for much longer. Death was inevitable, but she had to focus on the vial. When she fell, it would fall too, which meant it would shatter and soak into the soil. She refused to be the cause of the world falling apart. There was only one way to stop it. She had to swallow the formula. She had no idea what the glowing red chemical would do to her body. If a drop could take out a city, what would a whole vial do to her insides? The pain would be staggering, but it would only last a brief moment, and then she would fall, and it would all be over. It was the only way to save the world. Dying was part of the deal when she agreed to be a secret agent. She slipped the little glass tube into her mouth and ground her teeth into the cap in order to yank it off. But she was too late. The train went around a curve, and she was thrown against the car. The force was so strong that her grip was wrenched free and she fell. But she didn't hit the ground. There was another hand wrapped around her jacket hood, pulling her to safety. She lay on her back, breathing heavily, with the vial still safe and sealed between her teeth. In the cold winter air, her savior hovered over her.
"You can't die on me, kid," Dr. Julian said over the wind. "You've got to protect my family."
Ruby nodded and removed the vial from her mouth. She squeezed her nose to reactivate the link to the playground.
"Heathcliff, are you there? I have something for you to do," she said.
"Really? Oh, boy," Heathcliff cried.
Ruby set her mouth in a determined expression.
"I want Dr. Julian's wife and children taken into protective custody, and I want it done 5 minutes ago. You tell our people that no one goes home until the Julian family's in a safe house. This is top priority."
Heathcliff squealed with delight.
"I'm on it. You can count on me."
Dr. Julian sat down beside her, lifted the collar on his overcoat, and stared off into the beautiful green fields of northern England, which were slowly becoming more visible in the dawn light.
"So the world owes its continued existence to an 11-year-old girl?" Dr. Julian asked.
"Actually, I'm 12, Ruby replied. "And don't worry, Doctor. They only send me when James Bond can't take the job."
"And how often is that?"
Ruby sighed and turned to Dr. Julian.
"Lately, it's been every day."
Chapter 2. 38 degrees, 46 minutes north. 77 degrees, 4 minutes west. When you are a supervillain, it is very hard to get respect from the rest of the criminal community if you happen to be cute. And unfortunately, misinformation was terribly, depressingly adorable. She had big blue eyes, a button nose, tan skin, and golden hair. She looked like a movie star. Her peers, on the other hand, were covered in ugly scars and had terribly twisted metallic limbs. Some of them had laser eyes or had been disfigured by chemical spills. Professor Zydeco had an alligator head and an accordion frozen in his chest cavity. Misinformation would have loved that. But no luck. She was a beauty, so she was forced to wear a mask that covered her whole head. The mask had drawbacks. First, it was very difficult to eat a candy apple while wearing it. Second, it gave her terrible bedhead. Third, whenever she called a customer service number and got an automated voice system, it never understood what she was saying. Never! She could shout over and over again, but the voice would always say, "I'm sorry, I didn't catch that. Let's try again." But the mask did have two major pluses. The first was that it scared the living daylights out of everyone who saw it. She'd witness people wet their pants or even faint when they met her. That was cool. The second was that she didn't have to look at herself when she wore it. Her face, as lovely as it was, brought on a wave of confusing memories. Or were they hallucinations? You couldn't be sure sometimes. It seemed as if she had lived several lives all crammed into one. Was the handsome man with the amazing hair real? Who were the superpowered children that appeared in her dreams? Why did she sometimes ache to wear a cardigan sweater? Why did she have to resist the urge to go into libraries and reshelve books? What was the Dewey Decimal System? Why was she always shushing people? The mask quieted all of her questions. It made her feel sane.
"I bet they're looking for us, darling," she said.
She turned to her boyfriend, who sat in a chair in the corner of her office. He was wearing a tuxedo and holding a white cane, and might have looked very dapper if he wasn't a scarecrow with a head made from a stuffed burlap sack. Misinformation had painted a smiley face on the sack and hung a sign from his neck that read, "Alex." She planted a kiss on the scarecrow's burlap face, then hoisted him over her shoulder. Every step showered loose straw behind her. She carried Alex into an enormous domed room. The ceiling, which was held aloft by towering pillars, was decorated with intricate ceramic mosaics dedicated to the four branches of evil: raving madmen, world conquerors, firebrand pyromaniacs, and fast food workers. Below was a room as long and wide as a football field. Hundreds of tables and workstations filled the space, and at each station, busy scientists were working feverishly on bizarre inventions. Sun-exploding missiles, laser-guided death rays, armies of evil robotic beavers, tidal wave machines, devices to awaken prehistoric monsters. It was like a playground of evil. Every time misinformation entered the room, she couldn't help but beam with pride. Every detail was built according to her vision, and to think it had all come to her in a dream.
Misinformation, we've had a breakthrough.
One of her scientists hobbled across the vast room. She didn't know any of their names, but this one had a ball and chain attached to his leg, which meant he had tried to escape at some point. Misinformation hated when the scientists tried to escape. It really hurt her feelings.
Oh, yes, she said. Which one?
The scientist removed a folded piece of paper from his pocket and spread it out on a nearby table. It showed a crude drawing of a big circle. Beneath it, in neat print, were the words, talking, flying, and robotic ball.
Finally, misinformation cried. What took so long?
The scientist gulped nervously.
We apologize for the delay, but as Dr. Silver remarked, the design was a little vague.
Vague? Everything you needed to know is right here on this paper. Where is this Dr. Silver?
You had him placed in the cage full of hungry tigers.
Oh, that Dr. Silver. Well, that'll teach him to be a negative Nelly.
Actually, the tigers ate him.
And now you're being a negative Nelly? She said, huffing.
Why can't you guys be happy? I hired you to work on super cool ideas. This is a dream job for a scientist.
Actually, you kidnapped all of us and forced us to work with threats and tigers.
Listen, I've never run a worldwide criminal enterprise before, so you guys are going to have to cut me some slack. There are going to be some growing pains until I figure it all out. Now, you said you had something to show me?
He reached into his lab coat and pulled out a silver ball the size of a large tomato. He set it in her hands and pushed a button on its surface. The ball hummed to life. Like magic, it spun like a top and hovered in midair. Purple lights beamed from tiny holes and illuminated the walls and ceiling. Misinformation turned to her straw boyfriend, who sat in a chair, shedding more of his innards onto the floor.
Sweetums, it works.
She turned back to the orb, dazzled by its lights and sounds.
Happy birthday, Benji.
A deep, emotionless voice came from within the orb.
Who's Benji?
You are silly, she giggled. How do you feel?
I do not have hands, so I cannot feel anything.
No, I don't mean that literally, she replied. I'm asking about what you are experiencing.
I do not experience anything. I log and save what I perceive.
Misinformation frowned and turned to the scientist.
I'm unhappy, Mr. Scientisty Man. I thought Benji would have more sass.
Sass?
You know, personality. I thought he'd be snarky, she said. This wasn't how I imagined the robot at all. He needs to have opinions and a sense of humor. This thing is totally boring. No offense, Benji.
I cannot be offended. I am not programmed with emotions.
See? She exclaimed. Lame.
He's a robot, ma'am, with limited artificial intelligence. What you're asking for is simply not possible, the scientist said, his voice shaking.
Misinformation eyed the man disapprovingly. Then she shouted over the din of experiments and chatter.
Does anyone know when the tigers eat lunch? But we can fix him, the scientist cried.
Misinformation turned to her stuffed bow.
Really?
She said as if she were having a conversation. But I wanted him to be funny.
Well, if you think so.
With a pout in her voice, she turned back to the scientist.
Let's leave Benji the way he is.
She leaned in to whisper in the terrified man's ear.
I think Alex is a little jealous about the competition for my attention. You should get to work on the next part of my plan.
The scientist nodded and forced a smile on his face.
The machine that gives children superpowers, he whispered back. Yes, you got my designs correct. I have the crayon drawing of the chair that you drew, he said. So, yes, I got your designs. Well, chop, chop, Misinformation said, raising her voice so everyone could hear. Time's a-wastin'. The scientist darted off as fast as he could with a ball chained to his leg. Benji, welcome to the team. This is Alex, my boyfriend, Misinformation said, gesturing to the straw man. He's a master spy and an international man of danger. That is a scarecrow, Benji said matter-of-factly. Misinformation seized the stuffed man and gave him a hug. Oh, silly. There must be something wrong with your visual sensors. My sensors are functioning within... No time for chit-chat right now, Benji. I want to show you our evil headquarters. Misinformation hoisted the scarecrow onto her back.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.